Welcome back to Politics Watch. This is Sir P. Now, by now, you would have heard about an incident that took place in Brayton, St. Catherine, or Brayton, Portmore, where 11 people got shot one time in one venue. Now, today I'm going to tell you about not just the details of that incident and who were the main players involved. Of course, as you know, the name of that gang keeps coming up over and over again. Yes, we're talking about Klansmen. But before I go into that, I'm going to talk about Portmore. Let's look at this place that was once a beaming example of development and progress. Yes, I know a lot of people, if you're very young, if you come from Portmore, especially if you live in certain parts of Portmore, this might confuse you. I know the younger members of my audience are thinking to themselves, Portmore? Beaming symbol of progress, Portmore? Don't worry, we're going to go into it today. See, there was a time when Portmore was the envy of Jamaica. The original schemes were built by the Matalan-owned company known as Wicon, right? But late 1950s, early 60s, that's when Portmore really started to develop, right? The home started to get delivered to people, but then they call it turnkey housing, right? All you have to do is literally just move in, get your key, turn the key, and go in. You don't have to build nothing, add nothing, just move in your house. Now, most people probably won't remember that because, as I said, we're talking about late 50s, like 1959, early 60s. So I understand that most of my audience, or well, not most, but a lot of my audience won't remember that. What a lot of people remember is the Greater Portmore and the hype that surrounded that one. Now, if you think Portmore did Bossy, you won't remember Greater Portmore. When you tell somebody, say, I'll move to Greater Portmore back in the day, people looked at you like you made it. You were living the middle class dream. Of course, the houses were not mansions and they were not, you weren't getting an Olympic swimming pool, but it was a well respected area. People look at it as something to aspire to, right? And back then, people would proudly tell you that they were now residing in the Sunshine City. My earliest memories of Portmore involved leaving the place where I was from to go look for people who I know who live in Portmore or Greater Portmore, right? New people in both sides. As a matter of fact, for the sake of this conversation, I'm just going to say Portmore. I don't have time to keep splitting up Portmore and Greater Portmore. Anyway, I remember going there and thinking to myself, this place are going with things. All the homes look similar. They were laid out in order, right? The streets were clean. Things are going. Things are going. The neighborhoods were safe. Pitney run up and down out a door. It looked like some kind of utopia from off of the TV. Portmore was supposed to be the example of what Jamaica could be. But like most things in Jamaica, just give it time. Just give it time. Until the acidity starts to spread. Like the Big Sea. You see how the Big Sea has spread now? That's how the acidity slowly start to spread through Portmore. At first it was like, oh, it's under control, just like the Big Sea. People said, no man, it's like a small thing here and a small case here and a small case there. And then out of nowhere, boom, spike. Let me tell you about Portmore. Portmore is now one of the most acidic places in Jamaica. Portmore is now a chill out spot with some of the most dangerous men in the country. Some of the biggest criminals you can think of are now residing in Portmore. See, remember when I tell you I used to go to Portmore and I used to think, man, that place I really want with things? There are huge gaps between my visits to Portmore, and every time I go, there is a huge decay. The last time I went to Portmore, the area I went to, I had to spin around like 100 times to look good for the same place we used to come back in the day. It was a complete dump, with the smell of mediocrity, underachievement, and acidity lingering in the air. The whole political pit them when you saw outside a play, all of a sudden, the streets them empty. What happened to Portmore? I'll tell you what happened to Portmore. Gangs like Klansmen take it turn base where them can cool out and lay low. This was one of the original draws for Portmore, you know, why 87s and certain criminals, they love go Portmore, you know, because the area had this, you know, middle class, chilled out image and reputation. They used to go over there, go lay low because police never really appreciated the place. Police used to deal with the traditional quote-unquote Batman place them. You know, your West Kingston, you know, your Waltham Park and them place there. Right? That's where police really pressure the jungle and your Rima. That's where the police them like pressure some man from certain place. As soon as them get hot, Portmore is one of the place them where them clearly low. And you know it go already. From 1 reach, 2 reach, 3 reach, 4 reach, then it reach 10, then it reach 15, then it reach 20. And if nobody make the call and deal with it early, guess what? It then becomes too late and you can't stop them again because them completely take over the place right under your nose. And all of a sudden, the pit them used to could play outside any hours a day, all of a sudden them have each up behind a gate. Jamaican children in places, like enough little places like Portmore, they used to could run free. Now them have to lock up behind a gate. And this is not unique to Portmore. I wonder if people realize the history of some of these communities in Jamaica. Some of the places now that are known as Batman Place, if you dig back to the foundation of these communities, you will see a lot of them were thriving middle class areas, booming, even certain places you would never expect. Because now all we hear is crime and violence attached to that community. But when you speak to the old timers them, when you speak to the elders them, let me tell you all about those places. I want you to understand something. The reason why I'm touching on Portmore and why I'm touching on Klansmen is because that organization, an organization that is so thirsty for blood, that when it has no external enemies, it simply starts to turn on itself. Klansmen is a beast with an insatiable appetite for death and destruction. So when you hear the name keep coming up over and over in all different places, not enough people think to themselves, really? No man, something must be wrong. Surely them can the yaso and yaso and deso and deso. They are. Klansmen spread faster than the Big C. You hear the government that talk about them try to contain the Big C? Them need to find a way to contain Klansmen. Because it is associated with Spanish Town. Yes, sure. We know the Klan's base have bases in the De La Vega city. Have bases Jones Avenue, right? Have bases in Lariston and these places. Sure. But just like how Klansmen turned certain communities that were once relatively quiet, right? As I said, places like Lariston, if you see my previous videos, turned them into some place where some stories come out of it where a dopey show alone and think they need to come in. Right? It don't sound like real life. Some acts they've carried out, right? Probably the most infamous one is the one that involved Charmaine Ratchie and her daughter. People hear things like that and them say, well, oh, you know, well, at least over that side, they didn't know. The organization is dominant in places like Linstead and Portmore. We're going to focus on Portmore now. Portmore is home to some of Klansmen's most lethal 87s. One of them is the youth we're sipping your screen right now. That right there is Kemar Tummings, aka Night and Day. He was the first one to be confirmed dead after 11 people, yes, 11 people got shot in one venue, one time. This happened in Brayton at an illegal party that was being held after the curfew hours, where you don't know it got already, bad man, please, they can't tell me nothing. Do what I feel like. People are having them party, having them jolly good time. But as the old saying goes, Chicken Mary, 87 then near. Night and Day was one of the most feared youths them from over that side of Portmore. I wonder if you understand something. This is a youth who start bad from the Mago school. One of the man them who helped introduce him to the acidity was another 87 by the name of Tittyman. And Tittyman help for sure Tummings, aka Night and Day, the ropes, you know, teach them how to use this and teach them how to go for this and, you know, the basic starter package, how to be an 87. Tittyman was one of the man them who helped bring Night and Day into the badness until he became his own man, to the point where him start lock off ends and have him own local team around him, and became highly rated inside the system, right? And earned his place as one of Tesha Miller's top killers. Enough of the shooting him going to Portmore, Gregory Park and them place there. And Night and Day did a carry it out. Now, when I look at him in this picture, you might make the mistake that I do make anytime I post some of these pictures. Remember, most of the pictures of these 87s are taken at various points in their lives when either them all get some passport picture or them decide as some friend or whatever. It's not up to the moments, right, when them end up losing them life, because by then, that's when either them extra want, either them have to run up and down and them can't give a shave as much and them can't give a cut them hair as much, right? So we have to work with what we have. Let me just put it out there. Anybody who know night and day will tell you, it is extremely rare to get a picture of him. He was very guarded. Even when it comes down to him friend them, him never really taking a check, because obviously him know the system, him know badness go, him knows the badness is a friend killing game. And that is one of the reasons why he's been around for so long, considering how long he my bad, right? Now, every time the police send for night and day, him go in, right, turn up with him family, get them lawyer, him do him statements, police them can't hold him for nothing. Them can't hold him for nothing, because what? Nobody is going forward for giving that information on night and day. So, even time them here say, I him do this, how many times do I have to say it? It's not what you know, it's what you can prove in a court of law. And if you can't build a case, you have to let him go. They say them hold on for him, so them let him go. To the point where it become a cycle. And this is how enough of these 87s end up just get taken out by other 87s. Because the police, the justice system, just can't corner them. Cannot corner them. Every time they lock them up, you have to let them go. Remember, regardless of who you are, the law has certain strict rules. You can only hold a man for a certain amount of time. And if you can't charge him, then the man got him yard. So night and day, as small as him look, and he was a very small, he looked very short, right? My old time listeners will remember, I said in an old video, you have to be very wary of short 87s. When you see an 87 short, like night and day, them look up on you, it's when them take up badness, them 10 times more dangerous. Because them can't just shot you one time. You might shot you 10 times. You might fling with your hand and fling with your foot, because when 87 shot like night and day, they have to prove a point. They have to prove a point. Be very wary of shot, man. When you see shot man start bad, be a problem. So what happened in Brayton and how 11 people end up get shot? Well, of course, there was some tension already in the place, right? And the man then woke up at the party, night and day, was the main instigator, because he was the first one, the papa of gun, right, start bad up man, all kind of back and forth arguments start going. However, his rivals were in the same party, and when people see what going, guess what happened? Once the 87s, see a next to the 87s, a deal with somebody in a way where them not like, man decides that they might go defend it, people. The man them turned Brayton in a western show. Remember them western show, the way the man started reach for them gun and what the fastest draw, the quickest gun in the west. Well, it was the quickest gun in Brayton. The two set of man them start to shoot off at each other. We're talking about a party, a crowded party, and you don't know how that go already. Just like you heard me say, in Southborough, when the man them probably come for one man, and me say, listen, even come for one man, when them don't fire, all the dogs down the road, I get it. Well, the two groups of 87 shoot off at each other, and by the time they're done, when the man is clear up, 11 people pick up rounds. Night and day, end up lose film life. And on top of that, him actual gun gone missing. And I've told you already that when it comes down to badness, the weapon is more valuable than the 87. No matter how premium the 87 won't be, the weapon is more valuable than him. So, after night and day drop, nobody can't find him gone. And then to add insult to injury, there was another youth who was with night and day, named Marcus. This youth was wanted for almost years. Him end up pick up rounds as well. Last I heard, he was battling for life. We're talking about a youth to the police, I look for all over the place, right? Put out too much saying, bring him in, anybody have any information, please call this and please call that. The youth was in a party and enjoy himself at Brayton. How many times have I tell you when you hear about wanted man at Jamaica? People think say them in a one hole or hide and them spend 50 years in the hole. Not for them wanted man you walk one of the place. Wanted man a party, a drink liquor and a listen to music. Everybody a walk past him and end up on most wanted list. So, if Marco survive, right, because by the time this video come out, that might change, right? If Marco survive, he will be going straight from a hospital bed to a jail cell. Now, I want if you understand something. The reason why I touched on Portmore earlier, I know Portmore was this, you know, this community or this area where it was safe and, you know, it was seen as a shining example of what Jamaica could be. If you would tell people who live in the early Portmore or even greater Portmore when it just started built, that the day would come when residents would pack up and run away, left everything, they must take the essentials and run left everything else, they better tell us a lie, yeah, tell. They better say, look around, look how the streets clean, look how the place organized, see my neighbor, see my next neighbor, they will always know each other, we are talking about. This is 1991, 1992, look how the place nice, Klansman, gang activity, pack up and runway. No man, you're a mistake. This is not West Kingston. This is not Waltham. This is not Maxfield. This is not Jungle. You're a mix up, man. Portmore? No way. No way. Guess what? Are they support more rich now? We are here to say people are pack up and are run because they might expect instant retaliation. Your family and the youth them, where them say kill night and day, them run gone already. They've already left. Anybody who have any kind of relation with the youth them, where them say kill night and day, run me gone left them place. Sound familiar? Remember, I saw it start over certain communities like Tredegar Park and them places. Eh? Something go down, everybody run away. Remember, I told you there was a time in places like Tredegar Park when man sell them most for all $45,000. That's how much the place was devalued and nobody no want it. Man was desperate. $45,000 they could have buy a house for. Sound too good to be true, right? What more is heading in that direction? Imagine the amount of people were left, and not just the families, you know, just normal residents who just afraid say they might get caught in the middle because they don't know 87 and for them shooting already. So no people, anybody who has a little family one next little place are the snare and gone. The Portmore Ridge, the Portmore that was supposed to be the example the rest of Jamaica go follow, is now looking like some of those areas are going to end up like a going over a certain place like Lariston or T-Park. But man, I go say, listen, just give me anything you have and take the house. Me don't want it no more. Just give me what you have, come here left right now. That's where Jamaica is heading. The whole argument of, well, it not concern me and my era. No, it's just not your turn. Remember, you know, when communities did I get acidic one by one, enough other places in Jamaica did kiss them teeth and say, they're not nothing for the baby. Remember, you know, when West Kingston and the Waltham and the Remas and the Craig Town, they did a bad. Portmore, did I say, well, good luck to them. I kiss my teeth. Over here, so we there. That feed them problem. Guess what? Portmore problem now. And any community, any area, where Jamaicans live in, and their city didn't reach them, and them think they can't kiss them teeth and say, well, they're not afraid with me. Right? Me are the one, Serpy, I thought about crime and me not time for them food. They're not for me, cause my era, nice era. Alright, go and wait. Go and wait. Where you say you know, I'm playing a role in a helping return on the country? Where you say you burn out the PIA? Where you say Serpy if you didn't chat too much? Right? They're not for me, my era nice. Alright, go and wait. Go and wait, man. Because enough people think say them immune. Them things say it immune. Until one night them down in bed and they hear about 10 shots. And when them peep to them window and they look at them, see at them neighbor. When them ask what them neighbor do, it turns out the neighbor have a little business place. And clans say they must come carry money, come give them, and they say no. And the man then go for them in their yard in them peaceful suburban area. And now everybody here is open. Hold on. Gunman can't come here too. Gunman can't go this too. I wonder if they realize say. All the development them in a Portmore now. A some big wall a go around them. You don't notice. Anytime I build a new place in a Portmore now, or even certain place in a St. Catherine, all over Linstead, they might throw up some wall around these communities will look like say a GP. I look like say a Horizon. So you know what I mean? Jamaica is now in a place where even the residents who are law abiding, none of the badness, are supposedly free. I live behind some wall or come at them to jail. So now even the free people are prisoners. I wonder if you listen to me. The people they move free in a society. Right. Supposedly free because they're that GP, they're that horizon. Right. But which part of them live? If you get a sense of comfort, develop off a bill, some breed of wall where they run them. Right. Some wall where you need ladder for go over. That's the only way people feel safe if you live in a certain place. But the reality is, after these places, they are mental prisons. Because a prison don't just mean, say, you're there somewhere behind iron bars, right, like on GP or Horizon. Your home can be a prison. Enough people know when I build house, when I look on the house them, they're prisons. Jamaica has become so unsafe that man if you spend how much money upon how much big grill and how much big door, and by the time I don't put on everything, if he likes it, alright, even though you know you have a dream house, but at night time, the amount of grill you have to lock up and the amount of things you have to shut and seal, it feel like say are you down a horizon and you are a free citizen. You don't commit no crime, you don't rob nobody, you're law abiding, but you are a prisoner too in your own home, in your own scheme. The same way the prisoner down a horizon, when the warder say alright that's it, shut up the cell now, go in your cell and lock up behind the iron bar. And the same thing I go on a road. After a certain hour, Jamaican people have to lock up and go behind a few them iron bars. Except there is no physical water standing there, but there is a mental water. There is a water that hovers in the mind of every Jamaican. When certain hours come and darkness touch, the water in your mind starts to tell you, yo, come off of the road. Come off of the road, go on your house and lock up yourself behind the bars. Right? Lock up yourself behind the iron bars. So, in some ways, people have become their own warders. At least on the horizon are the actual water tell us if we go in. But in the streets, the so-called free citizens, they must be them own water. Go in, lock up, don't move, go over here, so watch the hours you come out, you know. Don't go them hours, come back in here, so. That's no way to live. That's no way to live. And if people don't want to do it for themselves, if people don't want to change Jamaica for themselves, fine. Maybe you're so used to the acidity. Maybe you're so, maybe the acidity has taken over your body so much that you no longer care, right? Fine. At least try and fix it for your children. Are you saying you're not visiting more than neither? Which wouldn't surprise me because, as you know, when you talk about unwanted pitney, so it wouldn't be surprising to me that pitney where most people never even want in the first place, why them they want work to make a better future for them. But all is not lost. I know there is a section of the Jamaican society, yard and abroad, that truly wants to see the nation become a better place. But what I've realized from doing videos on YouTube, right, just becoming more active on social media, because before YouTube I was not into social media at all. But now that I've been on various platforms, I realize, you know what? It's not that Jamaica doesn't have people who are very intelligent, people who have a lot of values, people who have a lot to offer society. That's not the case. The problem is, those people are silent. Those people are not very good at arguing. Those people don't want to argue or fight. Those people get overshadowed by LIQs. LIQs are very loud, right? They're very brutish. They're in your face. They shout you down. Enough people just go in our corner and make LIQs win. You see, the cold hard facts is that Jamaica is going through a mental civil war. See, on one side, you have people who are going to tell you, say, certain of these videos I will see with these little pitney, I behave certain way and I go on a certain way, and certain things that are being taught to them by their parents is okay, I must shut your mouth and mind your business. And on the next side, you have the people who say, listen, this is not how things work, this is not how children should behave. Right, and the two side them are go at it. On one side, you have people who are telling us, big up that gang here, and the big up my favorite artist, even though he's a known criminal, I'm a bygone, give the youth them. And on the other side, you have people say, listen, I don't care how popular your artist is, the fact that he's engaging in criminality means he has to be dealt with. The two side them are go at it. It's non-stop. It's not going to stop anytime soon. People have just make up their mind. Are you going to surrender and make the LIQs, make the acidic people overwhelm the rest of the country and the little scrap of values that is left to be completely removed? Are you going to let these acidic people and their agents continue to tell inner city youths that because they come from Walton, because they come from jungle, they must go on and there is no other way and they are destined to a life of death and destruction? We're going to sit by and make them put that new them head and normalize it, right, and program them to believe, so well, there's no way out. This is the only thing I can do in life. Are we going to sit back and allow these acidic people to over-sexualize our little girls and then make them grow up too fast? And this is despite the fact that we already have a society where we know the statistics about how much pitney, not just little girls, but even little boys, I get feel up and all kind of madness I go on. You don't believe me, ask the soccer. As me say, it's up to Jamaica society, you know. When you hear me say taking our nation back, I don't want people to think it's a joke thing. That is why I always say, listen, no matter waste my time, I send me a link or tell me, say, yo, agent, I said this boy and I said this boy. I don't have time for the nonsense. I don't have time for the gimmicks. Look around. Every year, 11, 1200, 1300 Jamaicans die. Me already shown the statistics. 400 and odd, pitney. Unaccounted for in a 1 year, nobody don't know where them day. Jamaicans wake up, go to them yard, and never ever get seen again. So, as 2020 is drawing close to an end, I hope people realize the battle lines are being drawn. And when the story gets told, when history gets written, we can make sure you're upon the right side. Because when the children and the grandchildren and the great-grandchildren start to ask the questions, if the country end up becoming the swamp of death and destruction that it is heading towards, when them ask the question, Mommy, Daddy, what did happen in 2020, 2015, 2010, 2005? What did happen back then with Grandma and Grandpa? What did they do to try and stop the country ending up where it is now? Better make sure so them pick they get an answer. Make sure them here say, you know, so them they try everything them could. You know, so them they even link up with someone and there was even a little movement here and a movement there and people that try warn people that try stop, people that try come together, people that try form a system where you can gather intelligence and gather information and move it across. So make sure you have something to listen to. Because you see, if them here, oh, them they also that hope for the best. Oh, them never know so this will happen. Oh, well, them they feel like, say, Uncle Sam will come save them. Or them they think, say, China will come save them. Or them they find out, say, them favorite entertainers were really a bunch of violence producers and they buy much gun, give much youth and a run program from people's life. But because them love the entertainment and they never want to give it up, them turn a blind eye and cuss out people who will try call out them favorite celebrities. Try explaining to them that they were professional footballers who like up and contract hit or shoot people, but because they love watch them play, you scream out, free my baller. Try explaining to these children that despite complaining about crooked politicians, and you claim say you know for a fact that this MP or this minister is very shady and mix up in how much criminal acts, when election time come, you broke your neck, the back flip and cartwheel, go and vote for him. Stop complaining, start taking action. Because these conversations are going to be very interesting in the year 2050, in the year 2070. Because I have a strong suspicion, the kids around then, they might go look upon us and the generation before us as a complete joke. And I'm going to say, you know what, only can't preach to we. Only can't preach to we. Because Jamaica went to hell under your watch. And you know what? They will be right. 100%. Remember, evil can only flourish when good people stand by and do nothing. It's up to us. It's up to us. Nobody is coming to save Jamaica. Jamaicans can only save themselves. Patreon squad, big up himself. PIA, you don't know. More life. Vulture squad, stay circling, stay scavenging. Bless.